Hi everyone. I hope I'm visible and audible to all of you. My name is Shivani Dalmia and I welcome you to this webinar session, which has the topic reporting with Microsoft Dynamics 365 Business Central. And I welcome you to this webinar. So this would be a 1 hour webinar from 7 p.m. to 8 p.m. I'll be presenting you the webinar, right? And if you have any questions regarding the topic that I'll be teaching you, you can put the same into the chat window because your mics would be disabled. So what you can do, you can put your questions into the chat window. I'll come up again in the Q&A round. That would be the last 15 or 10 minutes of this session. Okay, and then we'll discuss about them. Sure. So I think we should move forward with our session. So this is about me. Hi, I am Shivani Dalmia. I am an ERP and a CRM trainer. I provide trainings for Power BI also to various corporates around the globe. And before that, I was a software developer. And I have conducted training for various corporates around the globe. And even for Microsoft itself, I was the lead trainer for the Microsoft Business Central Readiness Program technical consultant held at Microsoft Bengaluru and Microsoft Gurgaon. And I have successfully conducted training for various government officials of India also. So I was a project engineer working under the scheme Future Skills Prime for the artificial intelligence and machine learning domain. So there I used to lead that initiative in NILIT. And in that, I have trained multiple government officials of India over this technology. So right now I'm working as a corporate trainer with Koenig Solutions, and I am a Microsoft certified trainer. I have various badges in my bag, like Business Central Functional Consultant, that is MB 800, and then MB 230 Business Microsoft Dynamics 365 Customer Service Functional Consultant, and Power BI PL 300. So likewise, I have multiple certifications. So let's go with the agenda of the webinar. Today, we'll be discussing about reports in Business Central. So first of all, what is Business Central? Business Central is an ERP software that has been given to us by Microsoft. It's under the umbrella of Dynamics suite, where we have another ERP software, that is FNO. Right? In FNO, what do we have? We have the finance and operation ERPs, and then it's for the larger organizations. For smaller and medium businesses, we have Business Central. It's there to organize their resources. It's there to plan their resources, and it does so well also, right? Then in the CRM domain, we have the different services like sales, marketing, customer service, and field service. So the Dynamics suite actually is bifurcated into two sub-modules, that is CE, customer engagements, previously known as CRM, and then ERP, enterprise resource planning. Under enterprise resource planning, we have FNO and Business Central. So today we will be discussing about Business Central and how we can create reports onto Business Central. So this webinar is all about reportings in Business Central. Okay. Business Central is actually available in two platforms, like in on-premise also and in cloud version also. So you can also, on-premise means whatever you have on your local system. Cloud means where you are accessing it through a URL or a browser, right? It's residing on someone's else computer, someone's else data center. So today we will be discussing about how we can create reportings onto the Business Central on-premise system. We will, if we get the time, we will discuss about the cloud also, right? Now in this webinar, we have the following agenda. We will see about the report introduction, right? What are reports? Then we will see the report components. What are different components of the report? Then we will see how we can design the data model and the design the layout. Okay. There are two things whenever we are talking about reports. It's always the data model and it's always the layout, right? We will discuss them, how we can create these two. Then we will discuss about the request page designer. What is a request page in Business Central and how it is used with reports and how we can design the same, right? Then later on, we will discuss about the report triggers and functions. So every object in Business Central, whether it's a table, a page, XML port, code unit, or reports, they have their triggers. So we will discuss the triggers also and how they are interrelated with each other, right? After which trigger executes. And then the functions, what are the different functions that we can use with reports that will actually help us to create the data set of the report, right? And then we will see the in that this also, this is not line wise. We will see about the different layouts of the reports. So we have the client side reporting, right? That is RDLC. We have the Word report, Word layout, and then we have the Excel layout. So this we will see in this agenda today. In this 1 hour session, we will see all of this. So this is the module overview. The same things, right? Now, what are reports? Reports are there to print our data or display any information, right? So if you go to any of your, like from Amazon, if you buy anything, right, you get an invoice. That invoice is also a report. Report means information that is presented to us in a structured manner. So if it is presented to us in a structured manner, we will call it a report. So here you can also read it about that reports are there to print or display the information in a structured and summarized format. And if you have seen the invoice, you will see that a logo would be there and the name of the customer is there. The items he has bought would be there under that name. And then the signature or the total amount would be given. So everything is actually represented in a structured format. So that we call a report. So there are two types of reports in Business Central. One is the processing only report. Let me show you via the whiteboard. Yeah. So two types of reports are there over Business Central. One is a basic report that I was telling you about, the report that in which we get an output, we can print them out, and they are the structured format and summarized format, and we get it, we get to view them also, right? The second report is a processing only report. Processing only reports are those reports that are only there to process any bulk information that we have. Okay, so if we have any bulk, if you have your inventory table, right, in that you have lots of items, suppose you have 50 items, and now you want to increase the unit price of those 50 items by 5%, maybe due to some circumstances, you want to increase the unit price of all the 50 items. Now, instead of manually going to each item card and updating the unit price, what you can do, you can create a processing only report. In that, what you can do, you can write your logic. That if some you that if these are my items, then just increase the rate to 5% of the unit price. Now, what is the benefit of using a processing only report? You can also do it via a code unit. Correct? So processing only report gives you request page also. In that request page, you can put additional filters if you want to. Right? If you do not want to update the price for all the items, but for certain items, maybe you can select those items, or if you want to update the price for different customers, right, you can select them into the filters. Request page actually provides you multiple filters that would be applied onto your data. So that you can do via the processing only report, right? So there are these two types of reports available to us. Now, this is how we write report into Business Central. Using the AL language, we write reports like this in the VS Code. So if you will see, first of all, a report description, we write report, the ID of the report, and then the name of the report. The ID is the ID ranges that has been provided to us by the CSPs, right, or from where you are buying Business Central. The range that they are providing, only with that range we can create the report. After that, we write the properties. Okay, we write the properties of the report. And then at the bottom, we write the triggers or procedures or the global variables, right? And then we put any labels, if any labels are there for our reports, and then request page. So that if you want to create a request page for a report also, we can do it inside the report description, right? And then we have the layout also. So let me just show you one. This is my virtual machine where I have installed the on-premise version of Business Central. Correct. And here, if I open my Visual Studio Code, you will see that I have already created a report. I won't show you this. Let me just open the Object Designer and show you the predefined reports that have been created by Microsoft. Okay, so Object Designer is a place where I can check the definition of all the objects that my Business Central is made up of. When you say tables, pages, reports, code units, everything would be there that my Business Central application is made up of. And I can see the coding. I can see the how they have been coded into the AL language. So AL is the language that we use to code different objects of Business Central. So let it get loaded, and then I'll show you the reports. Okay, so these are different reports that are available to us, and one of them is the customer top 10 list. So let me just show you the customer top 10 list on the front end first, and then we'll make map the front end with the back end one by one. So this is the Business Central UI user interface, and I'm opening the top 10 customer list. It's a predefined report, okay? Customer top 10 list, it's a predefined report. And it means that it has been created by Microsoft. And if you see this, the page, when I clicked onto it, a page came. This is called a request page. So this request page allows us to put additional information, additional filters onto the data that we want to fetch, right? We want to fetch the top 10 customer, but if we want to put additional features, like I can put, I can fetch top 20 customer also, right? I want to see the sales LCY or balance local currency, okay? From these things, chart type and all, I can also see them, right? So with this, we can put additional filters. And if I click on preview, so my report is now getting rendered. It will be rendered in some layout. Layout means the way we see the report, okay? So there are multiple layouts available for our reports to get rendered in. So if you see this, this is layout maybe. And now it is looking something like this, okay? Why it's looking something like this? Because I have changed it. I have extended it using the report extension. That is a different thing. So this is, let me just show you the vendor top 10 list, because the customer top 10 list has been extended by me. So this is the vendor top 10 list. Here I can provide additional filters, like for which vendor I want to see the report for. If nothing is selected, it means all the vendors, right? And now I can click on preview. As soon as I click on the preview, you can see that we are getting some information out of it, correct? So this is called a report where we are getting the data. The data is the name of the company, the name of the customer, right? The number of the customer, the balance. This is data that is saved into our database, but we are seeing it into a structured format. So that is my report, okay? Now let's see vendor top 10 list, how it has been coded into the backend. This is the front end. Now see how it has been coded into the backend. So if I go into my Visual Studio Code, it's stuck. So it takes some time. Just give me 1 minute. Yeah, it's on now. So I'll just type vendor. So here you can see this is the report. This is the ID. So 129999. These ranges are reserved with Microsoft only. They can only create an object with this ID range. So if I click on vendor top 10 list, it's a part of base application also, you can see. Okay, so this is my report. You will see that how do we define the report? We write this keyword report, then the ID, the ranges that we are able to provide, okay, or the CSP has provided and we are able to give. So these are the ID and vendor top 10 list is the name of the report. If any spaces or special characters are there into the name, we put them into the double quotes, right? Then we start the body. In Business Central and in AL coding, everything is very nicely hierarchical, organized in a hierarchical way, okay? So if you see, this report is the outermost part. If I collapse this, it's again stuck. So this is something with my virtual machine, no worries. So if you see that if I collapse this, nothing is there. It means it's the outermost part, right? Now inside, what we have at the top, we will always have the properties, okay? So these are the properties that we have. The default layout is RDLC. So if, for a particular report, we can have multiple layouts, whether we have the RDLC layout, whether we can have the Word layout, whether we can have the Excel layout. So Excel layout has also been added, right? And we can have multiple layouts. So now when you run the report, which layout, which this report will be rendered in which layout, so that we can specify via this default layout. We can also specify it at one more place. We will discuss that. Now you are creating a data set. First of all, when we create a report, there are two parts. These are about the layouts. And when we create a report, there are actually two parts. There is a logical structure. The data model means what fields we want onto our reports. And the second is a visual element, how we are placing those fields onto the reports. Correct? So these are the two things that we can do. Now let's just go back here. So here, if you see, this is the data model. We are creating the data model. Two things are there, data model plus the layout. First, we'll create the data model. And using the data model, we'll create that layout. So now data model, in that data model, we specify what do we want to get included into our report. Okay. So now, first of all, in the report, we specify the properties that this is the default layout that whenever someone will run my report, vendor top 10 list, it will be rendered in RDLC layout, right? Then we are generating the layout. That layout, specific layouts are there. RDLC layout is there, Excel layout and Word. So if it is RDLC, we use RDLC layout and equal to, and then we provide the name of our RDLC layout. Okay. Now application area is suite. So application area is where I want my report to be visible into. And if I want my report to be searchable into the search for page icon, I need to put this application area in this usage category. If you see, report and analysis is the usage category. If I search anything here, any report here, you will see in front of it, some categories also comes, maybe list, maybe task, right? And sometimes reports. So if I write vendor, you will see a vendor can be a list, it could be a task, and there could be some reports also. So vendor top 10 list also, it's coming under the category reports and analysis. So this is why we have to provide this usage category in order to make a report searchable, right? Now the data access intent, it's only a read-only report. Data set. Now we will be creating the data set. If you see, I have collapsed this data set. These are triggers, okay? Data set, request page and label. So you will see the data set, request page and labels, they are siblings. They are, because they are at the same level. They are not inside each other. They are outside. They are separate entities. So if you see, first of all, we'll create the data set. In this data set, what we are getting? So we are adding the items, okay? Data items tells about the table that we want to work on. It can not only have table, it could be different thing also. It could be a variable also. So with the data item, we specify like from where we want to take the data, okay? So data item means we want to take the data from the vendor table, okay? Now, whenever you are dealing with the AL language, okay? And whenever you're dealing with these hierarchies, these outer part, inner body, right? Whenever you start any of the body of any object or sub object, they will have their properties at the top. So if you see, that data set would also have some properties they have not listed here, then data item will also have some properties. So at the start of every bracket, start of every body, you will have the properties of that object or sub object. Now these properties belongs to this data item because they are directly under it at the starting braces, right? So now we are providing this data item table view. Whenever you find this view in the properties, view will always be there for sorting or ordering, okay, or filtering. If you want to filter the data, want to sort the data, want to order the data, ascending, descending, you will use this view property. Now, if it is data item table view, it means we are providing the filtering, sorting, or ordering onto the data item. So we are sorting it onto the number. Then we have the request filter fields. Now, what are these request filter fields? These are the fields that would be there onto the request pages. Okay. Now you will say, then why do we have request pages if we can put the fields onto the request filter fields? So request filter fields, as it is, will put these fields onto the request page. So here, see what are the fields. The fields are number. The field is vendor posting group, currency code and date filter. Okay, four fields are there. Let's just go to the UI and run this report again. Now you will see in this predefined fields, we have number, vendor posting group, and currency code. Number, vendor posting group, and currency code. And date filter would come into the totaling filter. Right, so we have these four fields. When we want our fields to be available on the request field by default, we put them into the request filter fields. Okay, and you will see that we have other fields also in this fast tab, option fast tab, the show quantity. If we have another requirement that we want to put our user defined fields onto the request page, then we can do it via the request page option that we will see just in few seconds, in few minutes. Okay. So this first, we are providing the properties. Now we said that we want to take data from the vendor table. Okay. So there are some triggers also that working. I'll show you about the trigger also and the flow of the triggers also. Show you the customer top 10 list. It will be easy to understand. Okay, till then it's loading. Let's just go forward. So the report design process consists of two things. One is the data model that we create for the AL language code. And the second is the visual element, that is the layout that we generate by packaging the file. So if we have the file, we package it and then we generate the layout and then we work onto the layout. We will see that. Then request pages, we have already discussed. Request pages are there to provide additional input before previewing or printing the report. So if we have any additional input that we want to put into the data that we want to see, we can do it via the request pages. Now in request pages, you will see that we can create a request page also inside the report body, or we can provide the fields via the request filter fields property, this property. Right now, what are this request filter heading and ML? Request filter heading is for the heading part. If you want to provide any heading to the request page, and ML is multi-language. If you are running your business central in some different language, suppose in French, so you want to put that language into language caption, convert it into French language, the English to French. Business central's by default language is ENU, right? USA ENU, English USA. If you want to convert it from English to French, then you can put it into the request filter heading ML field, like we have caption and caption ML. Okay, so request filter heading sets a caption for the request page tab that is related to the data item. ML is used for multiple language. And request filter fields is such which fields are automatically included into the request page, like we see the vendor posting group, the number, currency code, like that. Now, if you will see that we have various triggers also, correct? So reports will have their own triggers. At the bottom, we put the triggers. Then we come inside, we have data item. So data type item would also have their triggers. And the request page would also have their triggers. So object and sub objects, if they have a body, they will have their triggers also and the properties also. Now, these are some of the functions that we actually use to satisfy some of the requirements that is required on the time of the creation of data set, right? What is creation of a data set? The logic that we have, the fields that we have written into the report code, report ID, name, and then we have created a report in AL language. In that we are taking some of the fields, that is a data model. So if we do not want all the fields to come into our data set, what we can do, we can use these functions, these report functions. So what are these report functions? These are current report dot skip, break, quit, and preview. Okay. Now what skip does? Suppose you have 10 records. Okay. You have 10 records. 7, 8, 9, 10. Okay. You have these 10 records. You want to get these 10 records from the customer table. These are from the customer table. And you want to get them onto your data set. You are creating a data set for the report. This D is data set. Now you are okay with the first record, second record, third record. These are my customer. 10 customers are there. We are happy with those customers. We want to see their reports also, right? Suppose what happens, this fourth customer, now we have blocked this customer maybe because we do not work with it anymore, but the data is still there, right? But we do not want to see them into the reports. What we can do, we can skip this record. So whenever I'm on my first record, okay, I'm onto my first record. Then I move to the second record. Then I move to the third record. Whenever I move to the fourth record, I got this curl report dot skip. I got this curl report dot skip. So whenever I encounter this curl report dot skip, it is an indication to me that we need to skip this record. So I won't process this record and I will move to the next record. And then next record, next record, next record, until I'm at the end of my records. Okay. So this way, what we have done in my data set, I will have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and 10 records. So except 4, I will have all the records because on those records, I have not put the condition. So curl report.skip actually helps us to skip a particular record. If it's in a loop, then it will, if I give any condition that if balance equal to 0, then skip all those records. So I will skip those records. Break is to move out of the loop. Okay. Now, if you see, I can in my report into my data set, I can have multiple data items. I can fetch records from the customer table. I can fetch records from the vendor table. I can fetch records from another table also, right? So suppose I'm on customer table, right? And the next table is the vendor table. So what I'll do, first of all, I'll iterate through the customer table. And now while iterating through the customer table, while iterating to the customer table, I find at the sixth record, current report dot break. Now, when this happens, my pointer, wherever I am at fifth record. At sixth, I experience that curl record dot break. So my pointer will move out of this loop. Okay, so it will directly move out of the loop and will start to iterate the next loop. The next table is the vendor table. Okay, so what happens? It's breaking out of the loop. So now in my data set, I will only have 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5 records. Okay, so these will not be there. These will not be there, and I would have another extra record that is 4. So now this will become my data set when we are using the curl report dot break function. Okay, now we have the curl report dot quit. If anyone faces this curl report dot quit, it will just quit the execution of that report. It won't go to another tables also. Maybe after customer, we need to fetch data from vendor and from the item table. Now, if in customer at 6th level, it finds curl report dot quit, it will just quit the execution of the report. It won't go to any other table. The report would be executed only this much, 1 to 5. Nothing would be executed after the curl report dot quit. We are just skipping it. Okay, and it's not an error, it's typically ending of a report. And preview means if you want to use something like that, whether a report is printable or previewable. Okay, so these are some of the functions. Let's just see them in the predefined reports also. So if these are the reports, it's still loading. Let us reload it. Just give me 1 minute.
Fine. So what I'll do, I'll just open the object designer again. Okay, now I'll go to reports. In reports, let me just select any of the report. Okay, now I'm selecting the report. Thank you for the confirmation. I'm selecting the report again, customer top 10 list. Now let's just see, what do we have into this report? What functions do we have into this report? So let's put curl. Can you see curl report dot skip? It's there, right? So in this, what they are doing, they are taking the data item customer, they are taking all the customer, but they are not taking those customers where the sales local currency is 0 and the balance local currency is also 0. So why do we want to see any reports of a customer whose sales and balance are 0? So they are just excluding it, right? So they do not want to just make it complicated. They do not want to make their report complicated. They want to make it clean. So they have put this, if sales is 0, balance is 0, then just skip those records. Do not include those records into the report. Okay. And then we have the break also. So if after getting the record, we will discuss these triggers later on. If the customer amount dot find, okay, if we are not finding any of the amount, then just break out of that report. Or if the next amount is also zero, just break out of that report. Okay, we do not want to consider that. So with this, we can use our functions to make sure our reports are clean. Now, so these are this is the execution flow. So this is how my triggers are executed when we create any report. Okay, so first of all, whenever we initialize any of the report, so whenever I was typing this in the UI, I was typing top 10 customer list or top 10 vendor list, and I clicked onto it, right? So this init was executed. So I write top 10 customer list, right? As I clicked onto it, that trigger got executed, right? Now that trigger got executed. If you want to write any of your business logic onto the initialization of a report, what you can do, you can write it into that triggers. Why we have triggers? When we want to execute some action, right, at different places. So if you want to execute any action on the happening of any event, then we can use triggers. So these are some predefined triggers that Microsoft has provided us, right? Because they come with reports object. Now, when I clicked on to customer top 10 list, this trigger got executed. Now, if my report has any request page, so a report can have a request page and cannot have a request page. Okay. So if my report has a request page, then the page triggers will be executed. So because request page is simply a page, so page also has some trigger on open page, on closed page, like that. Multiple triggers are there for a page. So if a request page is there, it is there. So it will be executed. After that, we will be executing the on pre report trigger. In this, the initialization, it is an initialization mode of creating the data set. Right now, no new data has been fetched. Okay, it's only initialized my pre report. Now, suppose I want to get data from three tables. Okay, one is the customer table, one is the vendor table, and one is the item table. Right, so now give me 1 minute. Okay, so now if I put it like this, I want to fetch data from three tables. One is the customer table, one is the vendor table, and one is the item. I want to fetch data from these three tables into my report. Okay, and in this table, suppose that we have in customer table 10 items, in vendor table we have 5 items, and in item table we have 6 items. Okay, so now for every data item on pre-report trigger, it has been executed, and now my report is now in the initialization mode to start fetching the data. No data has been fetched from these tables. Now, one by one, it will go to each of the tables. So first it will go to the customer table. So whenever we have table, this on pre data item trigger will be executed exactly once when it enters a table. So when it enters the customer table, my on pre data item will be executed once, right? Now it has entered my customer table. After entering the customer table, for every record that my customer table has, this on after get record trigger will be executed that number of times. So for customer, this will be executed exactly 10 times because I have 10 records, right? And then after fetching the 10 records, it will go out of scope. And after that, this on post data item trigger will be executed exactly once. So this on pre data item means entering into the table, on post data item means exiting out of the table. Right, and this on after get record means how many records we have into the table, the data item. So for customer, I went into on pre data item, triggered once, then triggered 10 times, then triggered 1 times. Now customer done. Now we have, do we have another table data item? Yes, we have vendor, so it will again go. So for one table entry, on pre data item will execute once exactly. So for vendor table, it will execute once, then it will go inside. Then the number of record my vendor table has, it has 5. So this on after get record will execute 5 times. After that, it will come out. After coming out, the own post data item trigger will be executed exactly one. So for vendor 151. Now, do we have another data item? Yes, we have. So we'll go again. What is the item? It's the item table. So we'll enter once. Okay. Records, how many records had? 6 records. So it will execute 6 times and then it will come out via the on post data item trigger and we'll execute one. So for item table 161. So this is the amount of time they get executed for each of the data items that we have. Now our data items are over. So it will come in the on post report trigger. Now we have in our data set the fields that we have fetched from these tables. Okay. And in these records, in these triggers, we can put our functions, the current report dot skip, the current report dot break that we have seen here. Like this. So on after get record, they have put this current report dot break. And in on after get record again for the customer data item, they have put these functions. So in these triggers, we can define our logic how we want to fetch the data. But this is the flow of the triggers, how they actually relate to each other. Okay. Now let's come to the demo part. Okay, it's a very small demo, not a very big demo. We are here. What I have done, I have created this report, okay? And in this report, what I have done, you can use the code snippet T report also. You can use the snippets. It's a very beautiful feature of Visual Studio Code. For the AL language, we do not have to write anything. We can just use the code snippet to create the framework, right? And then use it accordingly. So if I go down here and I write T report, you will see that we have multiple snippets available to us and we just have to enter it and the framework would be generated. We just need to place the value in the placeholders. Okay. Now, this is the report. I've given it an ID and a name and then caption. I have given some caption. I can give some other caption also. I can give the caption in the French language. You can give any caption. And then you can provide the layouts. So here we provide the layouts. In the newest version also, there's a rendering section. In that section also, you can provide the different layouts. So here also you can provide, in the newest version, there's a rendering section. You can also provide the different layouts. So if one data set has multiple layouts, you can provide them whether here or there. Okay, I'm providing it here. Let me provide another layout or the Excel layout. So Excel layout, if you will see, I'm typing it and it's coming. It means it's a property of this report, right? If you press control space in the empty area at the top, you will find multiple properties that you can apply to a report. Okay. I'm putting the Excel caption, sorry, Excel layout, and I had to give this name. Okay. So you have to provide the correct extension. Right, so it will be layout lab customer list dot XLSX. This is the extension for my Excel file, right? And what's the problem? Oh, it's not available for the 8.0 version. Okay, so I'll show you that you onto the newest version. So this is actually my on-premise system, and it's, I show you the app.json, it's the 8.0 runtime, means the 19th version. Okay, and Excel layout is not available to them. No worries, it's similar. I'll show you that onto the cloud if you want. Otherwise, Words and RDLC are also enough to understand the concept, and then you can easily create the Excel also. Now, these are the layouts default. What would be the default layout when I run this report? By default, if you do not provide this, it's RDLC. Okay, but if you provide it, it becomes that layout. So my report will be generated into that layout. Now, let me just give it a name, customer list. So these are the two layouts. When I want to generate this layout, what I have to do, I have to package this file. When I package this file or build this file, this will be generated here because I have provided the the folder also, layout. So these will be generated in the folders. Okay, so let me just package it. Okay, not publish it. I'm packaging it. And you will see that one layout folder has been generated here with the layouts. Okay, now we have to create this layout. So first is data model, and over this data models, with this data model, we create the layout. Now let's just understand the data model. Default layout is Word. Preview mode. Preview mode means we want to view it in preview mode or the normal mode. Okay, in the print layout, especially how the report opens when you preview it, normal or print layout. Then word merge data item is used when we are generating separate reports or multiple records, right? It is used for when we are developing a report for the word layout, right? Now data set, we are creating the data set. So we have the first one is customer, right? We want to sort it by name. And then in this, we are getting these three columns, number, name, and balance. Okay. So we are actually creating a report. Okay, and in that we are using customer table, and from customer table we are getting these three fields, number, name, and balance. Include caption means whatever caption they have onto the table, we want to include them into the reports. This is for that. Okay, and then multiple properties are there for columns also, you can check them, right? So this is our reports, this is our report, and then we have the report triggers and all at the bottom also. If you put the trigger, right, and remove this on what and press control space, you will find what triggers are available onto a report, on init, on post, on pre, the same that we have seen, right? And then the data items trigger also there. So these are report level triggers. If I want to check the data item level triggers, I'll go to the end. Okay, end means the just above the closing braces. I'll put T trigger. I'll remove the on what and press control space to check what are the data item triggers. So on, after, get record, post, read item, right? These were the data item triggers. So there are multiple triggers are available. Then request page triggers are also there. If we have any request page, so we can check them. So now this is our report, right? And if you will see that I do not have any request pages here, right? But I will get one. So now I have packaged this. I have created the data set. Only three fields were there into the data set, and I have generated the layout also. Now what we will do, we will create this layout, the second step. So I'll right click onto this. I'll say open externally. So for the RDLC report, we need a Microsoft report builder. It's an external tool to generate this. And for Word, we need the Microsoft Word. For Excel, we need the Excel. So like that, we can create it. Okay. For data sets, I need to go to insert table wizard. Okay, either go to table or metric, and then because the data set, this layout has been generated via the data set, so the data set is available here. See, number, name, and balance. So I select this, I'll say next. So what are the fields you want to see? Okay, I want to see all the fields. I'll just drag these fields into the values. You can create your row groups and column groups accordingly. How do you want to generate the report? Now, this is how my report would look. This is a preview, and I'll say next. So now this is my report. You can just do any changes if you want to, right? I do not want it to be in the sidewise. I want it to be into the center. If I select the whole line, yes. Okay, I want it to be here, and this whole line also. I want to give some color, if I want to give any color. RDLC is a rich format. You can do anything that you want to do into it. It's about your creativity. Okay, now I have created this layout RDLC where we have three columns, number, name, and balance. Now I'll save it. You can have anything else also. And now I'll close it. Now let's create the word layout also. So I'll right click on it, open externally. And Word, we actually do the XML mappings, right? So what I'll do, I'll go to insert first. I'll put this table, see, I'll three columns, two rows would be enough. Okay. Did I add it? Yes. Okay. Just give me 1 minute. It will be all right. By the time, you can put your questions into the question chat window. I'll answer them. Fine, it's fine now. So I'll give it manually number. You can change it. You can give anything also. I'll give it number. Then I'll give name, or you can give it a name, customer name. Because this is manual, this is your headers. And I'll put the back. Okay. Now we have to do the mapping of the data set that we have created. So how do we do the mapping? For that, we need this developer pane. So this developer pane is not readily available. What you can do, by default, it's not available. So you can right click on the ribbon and click on customize the ribbon. Or you can go from the file and options. And here also you'll get this customize ribbon. And then you have to just enable it. Okay, enable it like this. And just click on OK. So you will get this developer pane. In this developer pane, you have to go to the XML mapping pane. In XML mapping pane, you have to select the schema. So the schema is because we have created this layout from the AL code, right? So it's already there, the schema, see, customer list, right? And with that schema, we will get our list. We'll get our fields that we have included into the data set. So for customer, if I select this second, do not want this one. I'm just selecting this, okay, and I'm right clicking on this customer, insert content control, repeating. It means I want whatever comes into the second row would be in the repeated format, okay. And now I'll go one by one to each of the fields. I'll select number and I'll say content control plain text. It means whatever will come inside this would be a plain text. Customer name, right click, plain text, okay, balance, right click, plain text. Likewise, you can select other things were also there. How do you want to create your report? It's up to you. Okay. And if you want to give any color and all to it, you can also give it. Where is that? Okay, I'm keeping it blue. So the RDLC one was, I think, red in color, and the word is now blue in color. So we can map it because word is also blue. So I've created it blue, and now I'll save it. Okay. So now what I'll do, I'll just go to my Visual Studio Code. I'll just keep it the name 50105. Either I can run this report onto an opening of a predefined page also by clicking a page extension. I directly want to open this report, so I'll go to launch.json. It's 50105. I'll put the ID in the startup object ID. And startup object type means report. It means whenever I launch this project from VS Code, I want to open a report with the ID 50105. Okay. Now let me just publish it. And by default, which layout would come? Word, because I have specified this into the layout data set. Could not be created. There is a problem. My bad. We need to close that also because it was open. Now it will be created. So directly our report would open, and it should open into the Word layout. And now till it's loading, okay, it has loaded. You see that I have not put any request page, still it is coming. So if you do not want it, let's use request page. By default, you have to set it false. Otherwise, you can, with the request filter headings, you can specify the by default fields that would come, okay? So now let's just preview and close it. This you can preview and close. Also, you can specify using the properties, save values, and I think it's auto schedule. Yes, there is a property. So with that, you can also specify whether it's preview and close or only preview, whether you want to preview it again and again. Now you can see because Word, I have set it as blue. So that is why it's coming in blue color like that. Okay. Now let me just quickly set it, set the default format. From here, okay, from here we have seen. From here we have seen how to set the default format. Yes. Now let's just change it to the from the front end. So from the front end, what you have to do, you have to go to report, layout selection, and then you have to select your report. And if your report has some layout, that particular layout, then you can select it. Okay. Let me close it first. Report layout. Okay, so there is a feedback link also in the chat window. You need to fill that feedback link in order for you to get your participation certificate that you have participated in this webinar from Koenig Solution. If you want to get that participation certificate, just fill in that feedback form and you will get it in maybe 12 hours or 24 hours. Okay. So this is report layout selection. You go to your report layout selection. Fine, and you just select your report. So you can search for it also. Mine was lab underscore something. Yes, this is the report. And here, see, because by default I've set it in Word, I'll select it RDLC. So if RDLC layout is there, it will be there. I'll run the report. And now it has generated into the RDLC layout. Okay, so with this, we can create a layout. The same way we can create the Excel layout also. And with that, we are done with our webinar. I hope it was understandable by all of you. If any questions are there, let me just take the questions. Please fill in the feedback form also for you to get the certification. Can we use Business Central for project resource management and project reporting? Yes, we can. How to link Business Central in other Microsoft features such as MS Project and SharePoint for reporting purposes? So for Power BI, what we do for Power BI is also another software from Microsoft. What we do, we take the web services, the OData URL, and connect it with the Power BI. So web services are there that exposes the Business Central data. If you have any feature in that, or you can create API like that so that you can fetch data from Business Central to MS Project, then web services endpoints are there. So you can do that. To have meetings on Office 365. Yes, so Koenig Solutions actually provides lots of trainings. So this reporting is actually a part of a course called Using AL in Microsoft Dynamics 365 Business Central. And lots of things are there in that course. We have the web services course also for Business Central. If you want to connect it with the third party application, we have that course. Then we have the functional course also for Business Central. FNO courses are also there. Office 365 courses are also there. Lots of other courses are also there. So what you can do, you can just go to the website, this one. Okay, you can go to the website and can check whatever resources you want to have. So you just have to type here, or if you do not want to type it, if any technology you think that okay, we want to check that technology, you can also check it like that. Okay, you can search for the courses, search for the technical answer. So you will get it accordingly. Okay, so here you can see these are the 17 results they have found. These are the courses that are being provided by Koenig Solutions, right? You can check it there. Then Using AL is also there, one for which the webinar was there. So this is the course that we do. We provide the technical. So these are different courses for Business Central. So this is the technical course for Business Central. Here we have multiple modules. One module is reporting also, right? So this way we can have multiple things available. Let me provide you the link. For rest of the information, you can contact Fatima. Fatima's number and all email ID is, I think, provided here. She'll provide you. And for recording, yes, they will be available on YouTube also. So yes, it is a recorded session. It will be available, right? So yes, the recording of this webinar will be updated within 24 hours. So you can check it from there. And for all these amazing webinars, you can anytime come to the Koenig website. They are free. You can take these webinars. You can understand if you want to learn more deep dive. You can take the courses also, up to you, right? But webinars are free. You can take it anytime. Okay, great. Thank you so much. It's time now. And I really appreciated your efforts of writing the feedback. And thank you so much. And have a great day and great week ahead. Bye-bye. Take care.